And now we have Mr. Navin Raheja. He's from Raheja Developers. He's also one of the luminaries from Naredco. And Mr. Raheja, what are your first reactions to the budget?
The budget is for lower middle class and marginal farmers, which is the largely voter bank of India. They have tried to balance both the things, you know. They have tried to cover the maximum voter so that they are taken care of at the same time.
It is an election year.
It's an election year. So it was obvious. It was to be like this.
Yes.
So they have, I think, adequately addressed it with minimum amount which they had to actually forego for the benefit of the common man.
Yeah.
Then for all other sectors, if we look, it is largely a very good budget.
Right.
From long-term investment part also. For
so let's talk about the pros as you see it. What are the good things that
the best thing is to the urbanites, I think it is more of exemption of income tax till 5 lakh. That means the lower middle class, salary class, or otherwise the people who are earning up to that level.
Or the young urban workers.
For the young voters. So it is very good for that.
Yeah.
But as you cross the limit of 5 lakhs,
yeah,
then you are losing everything.
Right. Are you?
Ha. After 5 lakhs,
yes.
If it is 5 lakh and 1,000,
yes,
then you have to pay 13,000 tax.
But up to 6.5 lakh, if you pay more
than
the PF.
Then you have the original exemptions,
yes,
they have maintained.
Yes.
So if you invest,
so you're then pushing investment, right?
Yeah, they're pushing investment. And I think the subsidy on EMI interest and the investment on basic payment of towards the housing, yeah, is maintained. Basic investments, whether it is LIC or all other
investments, are all maintained. Let's talk about housing. Hmm. Leaving more money in your wallet, will that bring the young urbanite to the housing market?
Certainly.
Because there's also boost to affordable.
Affordable housing.
Yeah.
You are going to get some additional disposable income with you.
Right.
Because otherwise you were paying the 13,000 rupees which you were paying, now it is going to be part of your EMI.
Right.
So you get...
That's a small relief for the...
Small relief, but there are some people who don't afford. So yeah, even the small marginal relief at yeah times triggers.
So let's take that in conjunction with the ATIB extension, which mm-hmm means that till March 2020, yeah, whatever is approved, mm-hmm, you get your tax exemptions on smaller units, right?
Yeah.
Will that also see more stock coming into the market?
It will help, definitely help, because you have to continue with the mission of housing for all till right 2022.
Right.
So had you stopped it here, then people would have, you know, developers would have stopped investing in the smaller houses.
Right.
So this incentive has just been pushed, you know, and I'm very sure it will continue to get pushed till 2022.
Mr. Raheja, one big ask from the industry was that there should be a stressed asset fund, right?
Yes.
Would you like to comment on that? I think
I was the first one who had mooted this idea about almost 3 years ago.
Right.
And for 3 years, you know, we were running to Niti Aayog and going to Finance Ministry that how it can be implemented. Although everybody says yes, it is to be done, but unfortunately, it has not been implemented. We must look at it. We should have looked at it. More than 7.5 lakh housing units which are stuck up.
Right.
This is a common man who has invested into it.
Right. But the money has been removed from the system. Is that why the houses are stuck?
No, it is not the money which has been removed from the system. It is that more investments have been made than the demand could cater to.
Right.
So the purchasing power of the customers was not as much. The overall, if we look at that, you know,
but we can see
demand is there, but affordability to buy or even to rent is not there.
But there have been some, you know, some money that has gone away from the system. We see that. Is that the reason why the government held back in creating a stressed asset fund?
No, I largely will look at it, you know, the stress which kept on coming.
Yeah.
the money whichever has gone,
yeah,
has more gone into servicing interests. I don't think the reputed developers,
yeah,
who are languishing in the jail, have money outside the system, and they are not willing to pay. No, it's not that.
Okay. And now let's go on to the hint that GST should be brought down. The FMS referred to it, saying that. Help us understand what your view on GST is.
See, the GST certainly should have been brought down, because earlier, before GST, the effective payments which were there, you know, we used to pay VAT, which used to, under amnesty scheme, used to go for just 1% or so. And effective service tax also, that also used to work at the most 4.5%. So looking into all the aspects, you know, we were effectively not getting more than 5.5% from the customers. Today, when customer is made to pay 12%, that is a very big deterrence for under construction projects.
Right.
This should have been brought down at least.
Wouldn't the states lose revenue? Is that why it is not coming for coming through so easily?
No. How come? Otherwise also this was not that much.
Yeah.
If you under amnesty scheme you take 1% VAT, instead of that, if you bring down the GST rate from 12% to 8%.
Yeah.
And then under affordable and normal housing as well, then effectively you have to give about 1/3 abatement.
Right.
Now that, I think that should effectively be the GST rate for India when it goes to real estate sector.
Do you expect that the GST council will come up with that? If they
understand the practical ground realities and the pain of the sector, they should do it.
Okay. Two big points that we're talking about. One, where will the money to complete the projects come from?
That should have come through maybe they could have floated some tax-free bonds from National Housing Bank. Mm. And that is what, in fact, you know, at the last few meetings in the Niti Aayog and at the ministry levels, which was being suggested, was if you don't have any provisions for money, do a bond or do something, some investment instrument which is tax-free or which people can subscribe to.
Yeah.
And then create an escrow mechanism with customers.
Yeah.
Those customers who are suffering, they should have their elected representative on the escrow mechanism itself. The developer should be there. The FI, financial institution, which has funded that project, they should also be there.
Yeah.
And then there can be a close monitoring by RERA or somebody.
Yeah.
That the money, whichever is now, has been put, first goes into completion of the project only.
Right.
And then only you can set priorities. Second is the FI gets, you know.
Yeah.
Third is any profit to the developer should go as the last.
The FM has talked about ease of living, right? Now, when you had a lot of affordable housing that were in peripheral areas where infrastructure hadn't yet come up, and infrastructure delays have impacted the sector, developers, consumers, everybody. Can you give your views on the ease of living context, and will it help the housing sector?
See, I think most of the state governments, the housing or real estate is a state subject.
Right.
If we look at most of the state governments have not paid attention to creating infrastructure which can actually make practical, you know, the living or the housing is not an isolated function.
Yeah.
Housing goes with economic development and those fundamentals as well, which are related to social infrastructure and other amenities around.
Right.
When we try to create, and which largely we are trying to do, is that we are not linking it to, first step should be, what is the economic engagement if a housing is brought here?
Yeah.
Otherwise, you are going to take these people, putting these people outside the city.
Right.
Then making them spend money on commuting.
Yeah.
And making them spend money on time is also money.
Yeah.
And making their lives miserable and then expect them to be there.
Right.
So that is why these...
While a lot of allocations have been made for rural housing, 19,000 crores or so, we haven't heard a lot around urban infrastructure. There has been no major allocation,
actually,
right?
Actually, the urban planning and urban infrastructure should be totally based upon your employment-generating hubs.
Right.
There you need to have manufacturing which is competent enough to replace your imports currently, because your economy is largely now import oriented because we have killed our manufacturing sector.
Right.
So the manufacturing sector you have to encourage by giving all incentives and soaps to make these young entrepreneurs. You have to empower our young entrepreneurs. You got largest bank of unemployed youth or underemployed youth on the planet in this country.
Right.
You need to engage them in gainful employment, and they have to be used for the development progress of the current economic growth
the
of the country.
The budget did talk about startups.
But when it goes to, okay, you give me a startup.
Yeah.
Where do I go?
Right.
I'm a young boy. I'm 18 years old. I want to do a startup or I want to do something. So where do I do it? I cannot do it from my house.
Right.
And you have not created that opportunity and infrastructure for me.
Right. Don't you think in an election year we may not have expected something that drastic to come?
No. I think we should do it. I don't want to comment on it as a political requirement. But it is extremely important that we understand for our country what is more important.
Right.
More important is, I mean, you may talk about smart cities or anything or other things, you know, but ultimately you need to give employment to this largest bank of youth which is on this side of the planet.
Right. We'll just welcome Amit Oberoi from Colliers. Amit, welcome to our show.
Thank you.
Discussing budget 2019, an election year, interim budget, but has generated a lot of interest among the industry as well as the consumers. So we thought it's worth getting the views of people across the industries. Mr. Raheja was talking about how they did expect a stressed asset fund. Amit, would you care to comment on, did you actually think that there would be a stressed asset fund that needs to push the industry forward?
Personally, I wasn't sure about a stressed asset fund more or less, but I do think that this industry, like Mr. Raheja was mentioning, is the employer, second biggest or the biggest employer for the company, for the country. We do need employment, and one of the biggest challenges that we have today is that there is not enough funds, there's not enough capital being dispersed to this industry.
Right.
So if we want this industry to grow, we need to have enough funds for this industry. I was hoping there would be some kind of an indication from the government to the banks that they should release more money to the real estate sector.
Right.
I did hope for that. A couple of things that to my mind came out right. One of the things is that now your tax on notional rent on unsold inventory is coming after 2 years.
Yes.
You get that moratorium for 2 years period. That was good. But I'd like to see a little more for this industry. I would have liked to see, like I overheard Mr. Raheja talk about tax incentive. I'd like to see something more corporate taxes. They talked about 30% to come down to 25%. That boosts the economy.
Yeah.
I'd like to see SEZ sunset clause be going up by 5 years. I would have liked to see stamp duty being subsumed with the GST.
Yes.
Those are things I would have loved to see, but this is an interim budget.
Yes.
And I also always say this on the budget is a little overhyped.
Yeah.
There are minor tweaks here and there. It really doesn't matter. I hope you all work towards generating more employment, more jobs out there in the market.
Actually, let's talk about 2014, the previous election year. We saw a complete standstill. The market was at a complete standstill across industries. This time, that's not quite so. Whatever momentum the economy had, it's not a racy economy, but at least we have certain positives. And as far as the real estate sector is concerned, we personally see that there is a lot of interest from the consumer. A consumer who bought, say, came two or three times to Magic Bricks before he bought, today he's coming five or seven times before he buys, which means that the buying cycle has increased, but the interest has not grown. He takes more time to buy because he's rather confident that the prices are not going up immediately. Mm-hmm. And therefore, he's taking time to buy. And also that housing has been delayed, there has been a negative sentiment. Slowly, this election year, vis-a-vis the last election, do you think that what a budget brought is?
Yeah, in that aspect, there are a couple of things which are very logical. Number one is to say that the capital gains up to about 2 crore rupees, now you can split that over two houses. To me, that was a nice thing.
Yes. That was a long-standing demand.
Oh yes, that was.
Sajit, please join us.
Yeah.
That was number one.
Just 1 minute. We are inviting Sajit Randhawa from CBRE. Thanks, Sajit, for joining us.
Thank you for calling us. So.
Okay. And Amit, please continue.
Yeah. So to me, that was a good thing. Number two was that now there is no income tax if you have a second self-occupied house. To me, that's very logical.
Yeah.
So
we had talked about that in an earlier show on MBTV.
Yes, we did. So I thought the way he presented it was very logical in the way that he said, this is the reason why I'm making these changes. Markets have been slow. There is more unsold inventory. So not having a tax on notional rent, which to me is a very convoluted thought process in any case. If I have not earned an income, why are you taxing me?
Right.
So personally, I am not in favor, so it should have been even longer. If I have not earned anything, how can you tax me?
Yeah.
Notional revenue, no, but what is something that I have never earned, should not be taxing me. So I think it was very rational from that point of view.
And the same logic, the 2 year, the vacancy tax has been extended from 1 year to 2 years for developers as well. Sajit, would you like to comment on that?
Yeah, I mean, see, it is progressive in the sense that these have been standing issues, and at the end of the day, what we need is a demand push.
Yeah.
One way or the other, the inventory levels are high. So I think from that standpoint, to A, increase disposable income in the hands of the end users, and B, to have developers also get that incentive to develop. I think both ways it should in the long term really help.
Right. Mr. Raheja, that clause of holding your vacant inventory for 2 years, how much of a relief is that for the real estate industry?
See, practically speaking, this clause should not be there, because when you have not earned, why should you be made to pay, and that too in the market where we are not, we are, how can we be held responsible for no sales and no renting? It is the market, it is the demand which is going to do it. You cannot go and force and sell anything to anybody. Or you cannot go and just tell somebody to come and forcibly sit in my house and pay me the rent.
Right.
So this is a market driven thing. So making developers to pay, it's not their fault.
But today there
and
is an additional...
When they are already suffering.
So there's an additional 2 years when developers...
Little reprieve.
And 2 years is sufficient time for the markets to pick up?
Markets are there even today.
Yeah.
But they are on a very, very selective type of inventories.
Right.
As we look at it, so we have a very diverse, as Raheja, we have a very diverse portfolio.
Right.
And going up to even 30 crores, each unit.
Yeah.
So we have a very diverse portfolio.
We are looking at where
there is so much of surplus inventory.
Mm-hmm.
There we are not able to sell because there is a price cutting. Customer may visit 10 times. 11th time again he goes back to some other developer's inventory and looks at there and then negotiates the price there. So the other developer is also desperate to sell.
Right.
So he may bring down little rather to 2%, 3%, 5%. So he again holds on to. Then he may come back to you after visiting another 4 or 5 developers and again makes you to bring down the price.
Yeah.
So this practice is going on. We have a surplus
There's an inventory hangover, right?
So that is causing stress wherever there is an inventory hangover. But commercial, yes, it is going. Those assets which have no competition, it is going. Affordable plots, they are going.
Uh-huh.
complete total affordable housing, yes, it is also going. So extreme ultra luxury is also going.
Okay.
Although the number is less, but the total ticket sizes are big.
Right.
So if demand is there, if there is a good asset and non-competitive product, the demand is there.
Okay. Do you agree, Amit, that across the board, all inventories are moving slow but moving across the board?
I would like to agree that. Agree with that point of view. And I think there is a definite push for affordable housing from the government side. That seems to be something which is moving faster.
The CLSS and...
Oh yes, Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, and the fact today that they've said no income tax up till 5 lakh, which effectively means 6.5 lakh rupees, yes, plus these interest subvention and others. So the government's push obviously will have to be towards the affordable
social side.
If I may just take a second and give a slightly lighter, in a lighter way, in a remark, this is a socialist budget in a election year by a capitalist government. So to expect, so someone like me to expect corporate tax breaks and personal income tax breaks was a little unrealistic to expect in this budget.
Did you expect as much spelling out of taxes and policies, especially since it's only a 3-4 month budget, right? A new government has to present a new budget by July or August. Did you expect that, Sajit?
Well, to be honest, I don't think they spelled it out to the extent that one would have assumed a populist budget to, right? So there have been some very basic points that have been brought out, like, you know, the income tax benefits given. But they've been very muted on recommendations to the GST committee, for example, where it is a long-standing requirement of the industry to promote, you know, low-income housing, and GST is, you know, an impediment in the construction phase, right, of course.
Also, so, additional taxes like stamp duty and registration and so on, right?
Stamp duty will come once the possession kicks in.
Yeah.
But in the meantime, during the construction phase is when most of us like to buy our homes. To be hit with a GST at that stage is something which is resulting in what Mr. Raheja was saying, a lot of people coming in and then, you know, still taking that sweet time to transact. So,
But isn't that a function of market economics? There's more inventory, the consumer wants to get the best out of the market.
But at the same time, you are also faced with a situation where, you know, if I were to wait, let's say, another 12 to 18 months and save the 8 to 12% GST, why wouldn't I wait?
Sure. So under construction projects are not top of the mind for...
So they've made the recommendation to the GST Council, and I guess that's all they can do at this stage, considering, you know, they're also cognizant that it's an interim budget.
Right. Each of you, two things that you really loved about the budget and two things that you were sure would come in the budget didn't come.
Okay. The number one thing that I loved is the fact that there is no income tax for people earning below 5 lakhs, comes to about 6.5. And along with the PMAY and the interest subvention under that, I think it's a good boost to the industry.
And that was the direction of the government.
Correct, which is affordable housing, housing for all. And they said 1 crore 53 lakh houses have been created, which is X number of times more than what they've created. So yes, hats off to them. Number two, and I have actually three, so I'm going to say one more.
I'll give
the number two thing that I was expecting, and which did come through, was the fact, what is good about the budget was the fact that there is no income tax on notional rent for the second year. To me, that should be extended even further, but that's a separate matter. But that is a good thing. The third thing is the vision that they spelled out right at the end. To say it's not ease of business, it's ease of living, because we all talked about, rather than smart cities, having livable cities. To me, that is a great thing, and it has a lot of connotations with it, because it talks about infrastructure, it talks about having a pollution-free environment, having all services,
solar
and everything. So I think that was a good vision I liked about the thing. The only problem is that's a 30-year vision. I wish we could do something, even, you know, bring it down to 10 years or so. I did expect corporate tax rates to be brought down, but this is an interim project. So hopefully in July, when they are back, or whoever is back, will want to do that, because
we today need a stimulus to the economy. And the only way that the real estate sector will come out of the current slow phase is a stimulus to the economy. We need that stimulus. So if you start reducing corporate tax rates or income tax rates, there is more money with the people to spend. When corporates have a higher margin, they will have more intense, more requirement to hire more people, more jobs will be created, and you also have more investment in real estate. So I didn't see that, so to me that was a big miss, but it was very naive of me or very optimistic of me to expect that it will happen in this budget.
Sajit.
Well, I guess expectation-wise, they've spelled out the right notes on, you know, improving disposable income in the hands of those who need it the most. There've been, I mean, that's pretty much which was expected, and it did happen, so that's a good thing. I guess apart from that, the expectation of a push towards, as Amit rightly mentioned, healthcare and overall quality of life. Yes, it's more of a long-drawn theme rather than an actual action plan right now on a granular basis. That's a good thing, and it was expected as well.
What you didn't like?
Well, I wouldn't say what I didn't like, but you know, obviously the industry is looking forward to clarity on the SEZ sunset clause. It's a huge amount of investment which is standing on the sidelines, both from occupiers as well as from developers' perspective, to understand where the clarity is and what's going to happen to these properties as well. So again, given it's an interim budget, maybe they wanted to take a conscious call not to bring it in. But I think that's probably something that should have at least hinted towards being addressed.
Right. And that would be a big boost to the industry, right?
Yes.
It would significantly impact the way
Not just the real estate industry, but also the investment within those zones coming in from overseas.
I mean,
India is capital starved to a certain extent. Global economies are looking to India to improve their foothold here. And, you know, that will probably bring a boost to investment as well.
Mr. Raheja, we talked about how a budget is, like Amit said, we overrate a budget and its impact because there are so many policies that go outside the budget as well. What about you? The things that you said, for instance, funds is the biggest issue that the industry is grappling with. Do you think that because the budget did not address it, is the industry not hopeful that some relief is coming their way?
They have no option. Let me on this platform say today, Indian government has no option but to create a handholding stress fund to complete the incomplete projects. There's no money with the developers. And no NBFC. NBFCs are already under stress now because they are not getting back their money from the developers. So NBFCs again have taken money from their investors,
right,
and they have to repay them as well. You know, see, this entire is a cycle,
right?
And you are going to very soon, you are going to land up into that mess.
Entire
economy is going to land up into that mess. It is just the beginning.
Okay.
You have just started reaching there.
Right.
And one by one things are started coming. But abhi to kuch bhi nahi hua.
And do you think that all these solutions are going to happen only after the election and a new...
I don't think a government which is going for an election can do all this.
Right.
Nobody can do that. They cannot afford to touch it.
Right.
So otherwise this may become a builder's government.
Right. I'm going to pick up two or three issues that the consumer, and this is where Deepak, I would like you to put this to the vote. We are going to ask our consumers that rental housing, if you have your second rental housing, if you haven't actually given it out and you're keeping it for yourself, there is no tax on it. And that tax, for 2 years, there will be no tax. Are you happy with that? We would like our consumers to join us and vote on our platform. We are also going to come out with small polls which we would like you to attempt and give us your feedback, and we'll keep telling you what the results of our polls are. Stress on capital. How is this industry going to cope for the next few months, let's say 6 months, while new funds have come forward? Will the industry crumble like Mr. Raheja says, or do you think that it will go over this election?
I didn't say crumble. It will crumble. I didn't say that. I just say it requires. There is a need.
Yes.
The industry needs funds. The industry, we only seen a small amount of problems. If we don't get more funds, there can be further problems in the industry. Let's talk about how will the industry cope over these next 6 months? Will you see a slowdown in the completion? Will you see that the industry will go on as usual, the housing industry? What do you expect?
I mean, look, my point of view is that 6 months is a very small duration. I think to expect crumble was a very, very strong word. I don't think there is any crumble or anything. Let's not set panic buttons here. It is not happening. There is no crumble. There will be stress in the system. It continues to be because there is no funds in the market.
Right.
That to me is the biggest challenge that everyone faces.
Yeah.
It's not, real estate is not a bad word.
Yeah.
It meets the fund that is required. And they are very right to set whatever regulations and systems they want to accept. Everyone accepts that. But there needs to be certain basic guidelines or certain principles that have to be adhered to, or basic infrastructure that has to be adhered to. To me, funds is the biggest problem.
Yeah.
If
consumer funds
ending at 11%, now today 13.5-14% with inventories not selling, that is a huge burden, and that's really not on.
Yeah.
And that's artificially done, right? It has to be, there has to be a guideline or a thing saying that, look, help out the real estate industry by having more disbursement of funds. That needs to be done.
Yeah.
As simple as that.
Yeah.
Overall demand, Sajit said this right at the onset, is that this has to be, the recovery has to be demand-led.
Yeah.
No recovery takes place because of policy statements that any government makes anytime, right? Now, the demand will only come over a period of time. It's not, even if you have a new government or same government or whatever it is, it will take time for demand to come back. And once the demand comes in, once the economy starts roaring, that's when you will see the revival in there. Industry. That's the way I see it.
Yeah. So you think the industry will go on as is?
Yes. Why will not?
Sajit?
I pretty much tend to agree. 6 months is an extremely short time frame to have, you know, any large semblance of change in where the industry is.
Yeah.
Yes, we are going through a bit of a liquidity crunch. NBFCs, as Mr. Raheja rightly said, are not lending as much as they used to. Some of them have internal liquidity issues. But, I mean, the crux of the matter is the developers are not getting end users to buy. They need something to help them construct. If they don't construct, RERA comes from behind them.
Right.
Somebody can take them to court for non-delivery. So, I mean, they have no choice but to construct.
Right.
But where is that money going to come from if there's no sale to help them finance it?
Right. Till now it was consumer money that was coming, that was the given.
Yes.
That is what has gone out of the system, right?
That's correct.
Mr. Raheja, I'll come back to you. The next 6 months is a period of trial for the industry?
I will say the extrajudicial activism and the mechanism which have come alive during last 1 year or so are really going to make a lot of difference.
Yeah.
NCLT, you know, giving judgments for refund or appointment of IRB.
Yes.
RERA giving judgments for refund.
Yeah.
Or sending them to jail.
Yeah.
NCDRC giving judgments for refund or sending them to jail.
Yeah.
And many other, I don't want to name agencies who have no role to play but still arm twisting to refund.
Huh.
Money has gone into the buildings which are lying half constructed.
Yeah.
And there is no further sale, no further cash flow available because there is no further sale. There is no further inflow from financial institutions, whether be it banks or NBFCs. Now, who will pay to complete the project? And as you as you continue, if you do these kind of orders for the fund or coursing to the, you are coursing to a developer who has no money.
Right.
Then what are we going to land up to? I want to give a little wisdom to our system.
Yeah.
Please, I don't want to name, but I think the wise people will be able to understand what I'm trying to say. If there is no money and you appoint somebody to come and take over the company, will the projects get completed and will the customers get their deliveries, or will the your financial system be able to recover the money, taxpayers' money, which has been invested into these incomplete projects? No. These will become ghost houses. And customers ultimately will lose their own CIBIL ratings and their... because they have to pay for something which they are not going to get for many years to come.
So here
so
we are going
people
to...
have to understand, the wise people in this country, whether on our political system or on our institutions,
yeah,
they have to understand that the solution to all this lies only if you help complete the projects and deliver to the people who have invested into it. And this is a mind-boggling investment.
Absolutely.
It is more than 7.5 lakh incomplete inventory.
Right. And so, this
and
is why
that
we
counts
have
to almost 7.5 lakh crores.
Yeah.
So we are talking here in the budget just a few thousand.
Mr. Raheja, Magic Bricks has been pushing a campaign called hashtag complete stuck projects. We feel that the complete the projects, all refunds, all returns come after the last unit is delivered. And therefore, if the industry, the regulators, the consumers work towards completing your stuck projects, that's where the industry
that's
will...
That's the only solution.
Right.
That's the only solution. There's no other solution to all this.
Mr. Raheja, we're going to say thank you so much for joining us.
Please subscribe to Magic Bricks on YouTube and click the bell icon to get new videos.